Hello everyone, welcome to Daily News Simplified, an answer to what, why and how of newspaper reading. Today, let us discuss the important news which have appeared in the New Delhi edition of the Hindu newspaper dated 2nd April 2020. The news to be discussed has been displayed on your screen and timestamping for the same has been provided in the description box below. So let's start our today's discussion. The first news appears on page number 1. It says, Center defines Jammu and Kashmir domicile rules. Move aimed at protecting jobs in Group D category. Now, as per this news, the Ministry of Home Affairs has come up with the Jammu and Kashmir Reorganisation Adaptation of State Laws Order 2020. Now, this 2020 order has replaced the term permanent resident by the term domicile of Union Territory of Jammu and Kashmir and has also expanded the scope of the word domicile of Union Territory of Jammu and Kashmir. Now, the word permanent resident was added through Article 35A of the Indian Constitution, which was added through a presidential order of 1954 through Article 370 Clause 1. So, as already mentioned, that this 2020 order for domicile has expanded the scope for domicile and now also includes such persons who are resided for 15 years in the Union Territory of Jammu and Kashmir. Also such persons who have studied for 7 years and have appeared for 10th and 12th board examination in any institution located in Jammu and Kashmir. And also such person who has been categorized as migrant by the Relief and Rehabilitation Commissioner of Migrants. So in this regard, you must know who are the persons who have been included within the concept of domicile of Union Territory of Jammu and Kashmir, which has been added through the Jammu and Kashmir Reorganisation Adaptation of State Laws Order of 2020. Now, this topic becomes important from your prelims examination and questions may be asked in the section of Indian Polity and Governance. From your mains perspective, this gets covered under GS Paper 2, specifically with respect to special features of Indian Constitution, as Indian citizenship is a part of Indian Constitution. So, this order of 2020 has been moved by the Department of Jammu and Kashmir and Ladakh Affairs of Ministry of Home Affairs. Now, this particular order has brought changes or amendments to many of the state laws of Jammu and Kashmir, including Jammu and Kashmir Civil Services Decentralization and Recruitment Act. And under this act, it has included Section 3A, whereby the scope of the word domicile has been increased. So it highlights that the 2020 order has inserted Section 3A in the Jammu and Kashmir Civil Services Decentralization and Recruitment Act, thereby enlarging the scope of the word domicile, and has also included more people within the meaning of the word domicile of Union Territory of Jammu and Kashmir. Now, the Jammu and Kashmir Civil Services Decentralization and Recruitment Act, in which Section 3A has been added to increase the scope of domicile, applies to gazetted and non-gazetted posts within the establishment of any department of service of the government. And it also includes Class 4 posts under any establishment or any department or any service of the government or under any government company or under any organization or body substantially owned or controlled by the Union Territory. So primarily the Jammu and Kashmir Civil Services Decentralization and Recruitment Act applies to gazetted and non-gazetted post and also Class 4 post. So Section 3A says that any person who fulfills the following conditions, that is these conditions, shall be deemed to be a domicile of the Union Territory of Jammu and Kashmir for the purpose of appointment to any post carrying a pay scale of not more than level 4 under the Union Territory of Jammu and Kashmir. So these criteria are a person who has resided for a period of 15 years in the Union Territory of Jammu and Kashmir or has studied for a period of 7 years and has appeared in class 10th or 12th examination in an educational institution which is located in the UT of Jammu and Kashmir. So either a person has resided for 15 years or has studied for a period of 7 years in any educational institution located in Union Territory of Jammu and Kashmir and has also appeared in board examination in class 10th or 12th in any educational institution which is located in the Union Territory of Jammu and Kashmir. Further, any person who has been categorized or registered as a migrant by the Relief and Rehabilitation Commissioner in the Union Territory of Jammu and Kashmir. Now, the domicile also includes children of those central government officials, All India Service Officers, officials of public sector undertakings and autonomous body of central government, public sector banks, officials of statutory bodies, officials of central universities and recognized research institutes of central government who have served in Jammu and Kashmir for a total period of 10 years. So children of such officials also become eligible to get the domicile of Jammu and Kashmir who have served in the Union Territory for a period of 10 years. Or children of such persons who fulfills the above two criteria mentioned in Clause A as well as Clause B. That is the residency clause with respect to 15 years of any person or a person who has studied for 7 years and has appeared for board examination for class 10th as well as class 12th, and also a person who has been registered as a migrant by the Relief and Rehabilitation Commissioner. Further, it also includes children of such residents of Union Territory of Jammu and Kashmir who reside outside the UT of Jammu and Kashmir in connection with their employment or business or other professional or vocational reasons. That is, it also includes children of such residents of Union Territory of Jammu and Kashmir who reside outside the area because of their employment, business, profession, or any other vocational reasons, but their parents fulfill any of the conditions provided in the above two criteria, that is criteria A and criteria B. So if a person fulfills any of these conditions with respect to domicile, then they can be categorized as domicile of the Union Territory of Jammu and Kashmir. Now, other important aspects which you must know is the fact that Tehsildar shall be considered as the competent authority to issue domicile certificate. So, the Tehsildar of any area shall issue the domicile certificate and shall also be considered as the competent authority. Now, there is also a provision of appeal if any person feels aggrieved by the decision of the Tehsildar. And such aggrieved person can file an appeal against the order of Tehsildar to the Deputy Commissioner of the region. And while deciding the case of appeal, the Deputy Commissioner shall hear the person who has filed the appeal, and such cases must be settled within a period of 60 days. So effectively, the 2020 order highlights that no person shall be eligible for appointment to a post carrying a pay scale of not more than level 4 unless such person is a domicile of the Union Territory of Jammu and Kashmir. And to be categorized as a domicile of Union Territory of Jammu and Kashmir, these are the following conditions which must be fulfilled by the concerned person. So this topic of domicile of Jammu and Kashmir becomes an important topic primarily from the perspective of prelims examination. And question can also be asked in your mains examination under GS paper 2. The next news to be discussed appears on page number 12. It says, the Reserve Bank of India relaxes export rules, allows states and union territories to borrow more. And RBI has also set up panel to review ways and means advances limit for states. Now, this particular news mentions about two important aspects. First, the RBI provides for review of ways and means advances for states and union territories. Now, ways and means advances is a process of taking loan from the RBI by the governments, that is by the central government as well as by the governments of states as well as union territories. So considering the COVID-19 pandemic, the RBI has increased the limit of taking loans by states as well as union territories by 30%. The second aspect of this news is extension of realization period of export proceeds. Here, the earlier limit was 9 months and now the RBI has increased this limit to 15 months considering the COVID-19 outbreak. So in this regard, let us understand about both these aspects of RBI's decision and also about ways and means advances. Now this topic gets covered under Indian economy in your prelims examination under economic and social development. And questions can also be asked on ways and means advances in your prelims examination. Hence, in this regard, this topic becomes very important. Now, in this regard, it's also important to know that Ways and Means Advances has replaced the earlier ad hoc treasury bills. And the government removed the ad hoc treasury bills because it resulted in increased government borrowing, and this led to poor financial discipline. So first of all, let us understand about Ways and Means Advances. Now we know that the RBI acts as a banker both for the central government as well as for the state governments and union territories. And in this regard, Ways and Means Advances acts as a loan facility provided by the Reserve Bank of India both to the central government as well as to the state governments and union territories. So under the Ways and Means Advances, RBI allows the central and state governments to meet their cash requirement in case of their temporary mismatch between receipts or revenue as well as expenditure. So Ways and Means Advances acts as a loan facility whereby the central and state governments can meet their day-to-day cash requirement in case of temporary mismatch between their receipts as well as their expenditure. So, under the Ways and Means Advances, the RBI gives a loan to the central and state governments as per the repo rate, that is at market rates. And the loan taken by the governments under Ways and Means Advances has to be paid back within a period of 90 days. Now, the limit of taking loans under Ways and Means Advances is mutually decided between the RBI and the Government of India. And when this limit decided between RBI and the governments is crossed, then the government takes recourse to overdrafts, and the interest rate so charged is 2% more than the repo rate. So if the government crosses the threshold or the limit of loan which is available under Ways and Means Advances, then such Ways and Means Advances get converted into overdrafts, and this is charged at a rate 2% higher than the repo rate. So it is in this regard, the RBI has set up an advisory committee to review Ways and Means Advances to states and union territories. And this committee is chaired by Sudhir Srivastav. So this news says that till the time committee submits its report, the Reserve Bank has decided to increase the WMA limit by 30%. That is, the loan facility to state and union territories under WMA has been increased by 30%. As it will help the states to overcome the COVID-19 situation. And this revised limit or increased limit will come into force with effect from 1st April 2020 and will be valid up to 30th September 2020. Further, let us also understand the reasons why ad hoc treasury bill was replaced by the present Ways and Means Advances. Now, the central government needed to maintain a sufficient cash balance or a particular cash balance, and this balance was necessary to ensure smooth conduct of business of the government and also to ensure that the government had enough cash at its disposal to meet its operational requirements. And any additional cash which was required by the central government or state governments was issued by the Reserve Bank of India as an ad hoc treasury bill. So, if the cash balance of state or central government reduced below a particular threshold or a particular limit, then RBI provided that cash by creating ad hoc treasury bill. Basically, this was a means to provide loan to the state and central government. However, the interest rate at which this loan was provided to central and state governments under ad hoc treasury bill was below the market rate. Thus, raising loan through ad hoc treasury bill became an easy source of money for the government as the rate of interest was below the market rate, that is below the repo rate. So the government started taking loan under ad hoc treasury bill for fulfilling its other purposes apart from maintaining its cash balance. And this habit of taking loan for other purposes became a permanent and cumulative character of the central government. Further, loans raised through these ad hoc treasury bill became an attractive source of money to finance government expenditure. So the government started using loan through ad hoc treasury bill not only to maintain its cash balance but also to finance its other government expenditures, and this led to increase in government borrowings, leading to a poor financial discipline among the state and central government. So it was because of these reasons that the ad hoc treasury bill was replaced by ways and means advances in 1997. So in this regard, the basic difference between ad hoc treasury bill and ways and means advances can be said to be the fact that under ways and means advances, money cannot be raised by the government to source financing of their budget deficit. That is, the government cannot raise money under ways and means advances for other purposes other than maintaining day-to-day cash balance. And these other purposes include financing budget deficit as well. So the government, in order to finance their budget deficit, cannot raise money under WMA or under ways and means advances. It says that ways and means advances is only a mechanism to cover day-to-day mismatches between receipts and payments of the government of India. Further, the RBI has fixed limits on ways and means advances, and any excess withdrawal by the government beyond the prescribed limit will become permissible for not more than 10 consecutive working days. And when the government crosses this threshold of the limit set by RBI, then the rate of interest charged by the RBI is 2% more than what is charged under repo rate. Thirdly, it highlights that loans under ways and means advances will be charged at market rate related interest at the repo rate. So these can be said to be the difference between money raised through ad hoc treasury bills and ways and means advances. Now, after understanding about ways and means advances, let us come to the second aspect of the RBI's decision. It says that extension of realization period of export proceeds. It says that presently the value of goods or software exports made by the exporters is required to be realized fully and repatriated to the country within a period of 9 months. So suppose a software was exported to America on 1st of January 2019. So the value for this export or the money for this export has to be received within India within a period of 9 months from 1st January 2019. So considering the present disruption caused by COVID-19 virus epidemic, this time period of 9 months has been increased to a period of 15 months. So it highlights that in view of the disruption caused by COVID-19 epidemic, the time period for realization and repatriation of export proceeds, that is money in lieu of export, has been extended to 15 months from the date of export. It highlights that this measure taken by the Reserve Bank will enable the exporters to realize their receipts, especially from such countries which are affected by COVID-19. And it will also provide greater flexibility to the exporters so that they can negotiate their future export contracts with buyers who are in different foreign countries or in different foreign locations. Thus, in this aspect, this period of 9 months has been extended to a period of 15 months. So both these aspects become important from our examination perspective, and questions may be asked with respect to relaxation provided by the Reserve Bank of India under the present COVID-19 situation. As already mentioned, this topic becomes important from your prelims perspective, and from your mains gets covered under GS Paper 3. The next news appears on the article section on page number 7. It says, thinking national, acting local. A planning institution must be a systems reformer and a force persuasion, not just a control center. Now, this article highlights that the Indian economy has been severely impacted due to the outbreak of COVID-19 virus. So in order to reduce the economic impact of the virus, there is a need for a strong and effective coordinated planning at national level. And in India, this must be done through the NITI Aayog. However, the article highlights certain challenges with respect to planning by NITI Aayog. These challenges are with respect to, first, lack of a long-term planning, second, granting financial powers to NITI Aayog, third, delineating role of NITI Aayog in center-state relation, and fourth, lack of integrated and systems view of economy. So these are the points which have been referred by the author in this article. So let us go through these challenges which are being faced by NITI Aayog with respect to a strong, effective and coordinated plan to come out of the economic impact of this COVID-19 outbreak. Now, this article highlights that success of national level planning is to have long-term policies. However, in India, there is a lack of long-term policy planning, as policies in India is basically made through a short-term vision. Further, this article says that these long-term plannings must be continued, or there is a need for continuity of such long-term planning as well as policies despite changes in government. As through these long-term plannings, the government can have a long-term outlook and thereby can design policies in order to improve different sectors of the society, such as health, education, GDP, etc. So there are certain benefits with respect to long-term planning in any country, and such a long-term planning has been observed in China. Now, in this respect, the article highlights certain problems with respect to India in long-term planning. The article says that frequent changes in government has led to frequent changes in policies, and these policies framed by changing governments are made for a short-term vision. So in this regard, this article says that short-term outlook in democratic countries has led to poor outcomes because such democratic countries are framing policies to suit their short-term goal. And it is in this regard, this article highlights about planning in India with respect to NITI Aayog and also with respect to erstwhile Planning Commission of India. This article says that NITI Aayog as well as the erstwhile Planning Commission are not constitutional bodies, and hence they lack effective mandate with respect to planning and are also forced to work as per the requirements of the central government. So basically, this article highlights about lack of independence of present NITI Aayog and erstwhile Planning Commission with respect to their day-to-day functioning in regards to planning, as these bodies are not constitutional bodies and has to work as per the requirements of the central government. So in this regard, the author mentions about providing or allocating financial power to the present NITI Aayog. So the question is that should NITI Aayog be empowered to allocate the finances? Now, this debate with respect to providing financial power to NITI Aayog has been going on among the economists. Even Dr. Vijay Kelkar has suggested or mooted an idea to give financial powers to NITI Aayog and thereby has suggested for a NITI Aayog too in one of his research papers. Further, the RBI governor has also pitched to grant permanent status to Finance Commission, which is another body with respect to distribution of funds to different states. So here, while discussing allocation of financial powers to NITI Aayog, the author has also mentioned about Finance Commission and also Planning Commission as pillars of fiscal federalism. So as already mentioned, that there has been a growing debate among economists to grant financial powers to NITI Aayog for a balanced regional development. Now, this article says that this debate should be quickly resolved so that the present NITI Aayog has a strong and effective mandate with respect to long-term planning policies in India. So in this regard, this article highlights that a transfer of fund was earlier also done by the Planning Commission for a balanced regional development of the states in India. However, in 2014, the government dismantled the Planning Commission and it was replaced by the NITI Aayog. However, the NITI Aayog does not have any financial power to distribute funds among the states. Now, in this regard, it's important to note that this transfer of funds to states as of now is done by Finance Commission under Article 275, whereas earlier, such distribution of fund was also done by the Planning Commission under Article 282 of the Indian Constitution. And Finance Commission of India is constituted every 5 years as per Article 280 of the Indian Constitution. So in this regard, this article says that as of now, India's fiscal federalism, that is distribution of funds for a balanced regional development, as of now stand only on one pillar. That is, it is done only by the Finance Commission as of now. And therefore, the entire mechanism of fiscal federalism in India is comparatively weak. And this needs to be fixed. And it is here where allocating financial powers to NITI Aayog will help. So this article has mentioned that providing financial power to NITI Aayog will further strengthen NITI Aayog as a body, and it will also help in improving center-state relations, as NITI Aayog, just like Planning Commission, will have the power to distribute funds for a balanced regional development of India. Accordingly, the article also mentions the role of NITI Aayog in maintaining a strong center-state relationships. In this regard, the article highlights that as of now, the role of NITI Aayog has reduced in center-state relation as it does not have any financial power to distribute funds. And also because of the fact that the task of distribution or financial allocation is done only by the Finance Commission, that is only the one pillar of fiscal federalism. So in this regard, this article says that without any financial powers, NITI Aayog is expected to advise states on developmental policies, and this has been questioned by many states. Now, according to different states, NITI Aayog members are armchair experts and do not have or have relatively lesser experience as well as awareness with respect to ground realities of the states. Hence, advisory given by different members of NITI Aayog to states have been questioned by different states. And accordingly, the role of NITI Aayog in maintaining a strong center-state relation has comparatively weakened, as its authority has been questioned by states on lack of ground realities or on lack of experience on the field. Next, the fourth point is with respect to lack of integrated and systems view of economy. Now, economy of any country can be considered as a form of system having different or consisting of a number of subsystems, such as society, polity, administration, environment, etc. Now, these subsystems may be independent, yet these different subsystems of a society interact with each other in unique ways, and this interaction of these subsystems leads to unique outcomes based on two aspects. First, based on their interaction, and second, based on the choices made through such interaction. And both these determine the outcomes in any given society. And these outcomes can vary across region, district, states, nation, and even countries. So the interaction of these subsystems in a society depends on the kind of a polity a country has and what sort of interaction do these subsystems make. So in this regard, this article says that differences in society and polity between two countries, namely India and China, has led to differences in their economic outcomes in these two countries because their subsystems interact in a very different way, and the outcome of their interaction is also different in two different countries, namely India as well as China. So, even policy designed at a national level may have different outcomes in different states or even different districts due to differences in their society, administration, environment, etc. Thus, planning within any country must consider this integrated and systems view in a society. So, this article highlights that policy design at national level must account for these subsystems and their interaction at local, regional, and national level, as such interaction between the subsystems in a society will determine the outcome of any long-term policy taken by the government. So, in this regard, the government must consider the integrated and systems view of the economy while planning any policy at the national level. So it is in this regard the author highlights that while determining the national policy, local issues must be considered. So effectively, this article says that there is a need to develop local solutions to our national problems. Now this topic becomes important primarily from your mains perspective. It gets covered under GS Paper 3 under Indian Economy, and in GS Paper 2 with respect to appointment to various constitutional posts and also statutory, regulatory and various quasi-judicial body. The next news also appears on page number 7 in the article section. It says, the battle to set oil prices. Russia's move to reject production cuts is driven by its strategy of denying market share to the United States shale producers. Now considering the COVID-19 outbreak, there was a continuous decline in the price of crude oil in the international market. So to prevent further decline of this price of crude oil in the international market, Saudi Arabia, the leader of OPEC countries, met along with the OPEC Plus countries, including Russia. However, Russia did not agree to sign the agreement with respect to decline in supply cut. Basically, Saudi Arabia wanted Russia and other OPEC and OPEC Plus countries to reduce supply or to decrease supply, as decreasing supply of the crude oil would have helped in maintaining the price of the crude oil in the international market. However, Russia did not agree to this agreement of Saudi Arabia, as Russia, first of all, does not want to reduce its supply of crude oil to the international market. And second, Russia does not want the United States to enter into the market as it produces shale oil. So in this regard, Russia's strategy is basically to deny market share of crude to shale oil of United States and also to cripple United States' shale gas industry. Now, one of the main reasons of Russia's strategy is to continue supplying crude oil to the rest of the world, including China, as Russia competes with Saudi Arabia to supply crude oil to China. Also because of the fact that China is much closer to Russia and the logistic cost for Russia to supply crude to China is comparatively less as compared to supplying crude to other countries. So here also, with respect to supplying crude oil to China, it's competing with Saudi Arabia, which is the leader of OPEC countries. So in this regard, it's important to understand that both Russia as well as China depend heavily on crude export, and their crude export accounts for more than 80% of their export revenue. So in this regard, both Russia and Saudi Arabia does not want to lose their share in the market of crude oil supply. Now, another reason why Russia does not want United States to enter into the market is the fact that Washington used geopolitics for commercial reason to ban Russia's gas pipeline project across the Baltic Sea, which was carrying Serbian gas to Germany, as Germany is one of the major consumers of Russian energy. So despite decline in international price for crude oil, Russia has not agreed to stop its production of crude oil, as it not only wants to cripple US shale gas industry, but it is also competing with Saudi Arabia with respect to export of crude oil in the international market. So considering the situation, even the Saudi government has agreed to supply crude at lower rate to India as well as China. Now it's important to note that 80% of energy requirement of India is met by its imports. So in this situation, import of cheap crude oil will definitely benefit India. So with respect to reasons for Russia to withdraw, it is highlighted that both Russia and Saudi are leading producers of oil in the world, and they are competing for supplying cheaper oil to predominantly the Chinese market. Next, it says that since 2014, United States has also entered the race as a result of shale oil production. So accordingly, it has been highlighted in this article that Russia has withdrawn from the deal to keep the oil prices low and drive away competition from United States shale production. So this is the energy war which has been highlighted in this particular article, especially with respect to Russia, Saudi Arabia and United States. So lowering of crude oil prices in international market also has an impact on importing countries such as India. First of all, it reduces India's import bill of crude oil. Now we have already seen that India imports more than 80% of the crude oil from international market. So in this regard, decline in price of international crude oil will reduce India's import bill. In this regard, it highlights that with a single dollar decrease in price of crude, it means that over $1.2 billion decrease in our oil import bills. And this decrease in oil import bill will also narrow the current account deficit, as less rupee would be required to purchase the prescribed crude oil. It says that a fall in oil price would drive down the value of its imports, and this will also narrow India's current account deficit, as India has to pay less amount for the required amount of import of such crude oil. So it says that according to certain estimates, fall in oil prices by $10 per barrel helps in reducing the current account deficit by $9.2 billion, which is close to nearly 0.43% of the GDP. So this is the amount of money which the government of India will save in the current situation of declining crude oil prices. Further, reducing current account deficit will also decrease inflation in the economy, as it will reduce the cost of petrol, diesel and other related products in the country. Thus, this topic becomes important from the perspective of prelims as well as from the perspective of mains examination. Now, this news had mentioned that Russia was building a gas pipeline project across the Baltic Sea. So, in this regard, you must go through the world map with respect to Baltic Sea. As you can see in this picture, this is the Baltic Sea, and the surrounding countries are Poland, Russia, Lithuania, Latvia, Estonia, Sweden, as well as Finland. Whereas close to Baltic Sea, there is a Gulf of Bothnia. And this Gulf of Bothnia is between Sweden as well as Finland. So again, this become important from a perspective of world map. So from prelims point of view, this topic becomes a part of current events of international importance as well as Indian economy. And from your mains perspective, it gets covered under GS paper 2, specifically with respect to international relations, and also GS paper 3 with respect to Indian economy. The next news for discussion appears on page number 6 in the article section. It says, still no bull's eye in volume and value. India's defense model faces challenges despite the positive trends generated by Make in India. Now this topic highlights about a report by Stockholm International Peace Research Institute, which covers the total period between 2009-13 and 2014-18 with respect to India's defense import as well as export. Now this report highlights that there is a clear evidence that there has been a rise in Indian's defense exports, and this rise in defense exports has been accompanied by a decline in imports at the same time. In this regard, this report highlights that in the last two fiscal years, that is in 2017-18 and 2018-19, exports have witnessed a surge from Rs 7,500 crore to Rs 11,000 crore. And this represents a surge of 40% in exports of defense equipments from India. Now this topic becomes important particularly with respect to Make in India aspect of defense equipments. From your examination perspective, it gets covered under GS paper 3, specifically with respect to achievement of Indians in science and technology and indigenization of technology and developing new technology. So the question is that what is the cause behind this trend of declining import and increase in export of defense equipments? First of all, it highlights that Make in India scheme of the Government of India seems to be playing a major role. Now under this Make in India initiative, a large number of components from Indian private and public sector enterprises have been prioritized by the Indian government. So these equipments under Make in India are being manufactured within the country itself. Next question is, how Make in India has impacted defense imports? Now, in pursuance of Make in India initiative, the government has laid down defense procurement procedure, and it lays out the following aspects. It lays down conditions, regulations, and requirements for defense acquisitions. It lays down measures necessary to build India's defense industry, and it has also created various categories for defense acquisition. First, buy Indian indigenously designed, developed, and manufactured category, which is a new category designed by the Ministry of Defense, and simplification of make category, which has reserved certain projects under certain limits for the MSME sector. So because of all these aspects cumulatively, import of defense equipments in India has seen a decline. Another reason for decline in import is because of cancellation or delay of orders. Now it says that delays in supplying equipments by vendors and outright cancellation of certain contracts by the Indian government, or at least diminution of the existing contract, has also resulted in decline in import of certain defense equipments. Now the article has highlighted the example of Rafale, whereby the government has reduced acquisition from 126 aircraft to the present 36 aircraft. Further, joint project of Su-77 development with Russia has been cancelled. And it highlights many other delays. Says that delays in supplies of T-90 battle tanks, Su-30 combat aircraft from Russia, and submarines from France, all these have cumulatively resulted in decline in imports of defense equipments in India. Further, the article also highlights about the steps taken by the Indian government to increase export. First is with respect to delisting. It says that the government in 2014 delisted or removed several products that were restricted from exports. Then the government removed the NOC requirement and this eased export of certain defense equipments. It says that government removed the erstwhile no objection certificate requirement under the defense procurement project, as it restricted exports of aerospace products and several dual use items. So removal of NOC requirement did away with 2/3 of all products under these heads. Thus the question is that what are the main takeaways from these trends? That is, trend of declining import and that of increase in export. It highlights that from a volume and value standpoint, Indian defense exports, while showing a promising upward trend, still remain uncompetitive globally. So Indian exports in the global market still remains uncompetitive. It further highlights that it is likely that Indian defense export will take several years before they are considered attractive by external buyers or buyers in the international market. However, there are certain positives with respect to export of defense equipments from India in the international market. And in this regard, the Indian policymakers must provide a certain platform whereby more export of defense equipments can take place from India. Thus, this article becomes important primarily from the perspective of your mains examination with respect to GS paper 3. Now, after our discussion, let us go through the summary for today's news which are important from the upcoming prelims of 2020. First, new domicile rules for Union Territory of Jammu and Kashmir. Next, ways and means advances, important requirements of ways and means advances, relaxation in rules by RBI due to COVID-19 situation, as it is used for loan for cash balance of governments. Ad hoc Treasury Bill, because ways and means advances replaced the Ad hoc Treasury Bill in 1997. And important features of Ad hoc Treasury Bill. Advisory Committee to review ways and means advances, as the committee is chaired by Sudhir Srivastava. Important aspects of NITI Aayog, Finance Commission, as well as erstwhile Planning Commission. And in this regard, Article 280, Article 275 and Article 282 becomes important. Next, systems view of economy should be understood, including its various subsystems. Next, you should know about energy war with respect to declining crude oil prices, where Russia, Saudi Arabia and USA are primarily involved. This news also highlighted about Baltic Sea. So in this regard, you should know the location of Baltic Sea in the world map. Next, you should know about impact of declining crude oil prices in India. Next, a report by Stockholm International Peace Research Institute, which covers the period between 2009-13 and 2014-18. Now, UPSC has started asking questions with respect to different trends. So in this regard, the trend of declining import and increase in export of defense equipments becomes important. And also, the role played by Make in India in this trend. And also about defense procurement procedure. So these can be said to be the summary for your prelims for today, that is 2nd April 2020. With this, let us move to the question for the day. Now, after our discussion, this is the question for the day for today. The question is, which of the following can be said to be the likely effect of declining crude oil prices in the international market on Indian economy? Options are 1. Widening current account deficit. 2. Increase in inflation. 3. Depreciation of rupee. Question is, select the correct answer using the code given below. Options are A. 1 and 2 only. B. 2 and 3 only. C. 1 and 3 only, and D. None of the above. Now coming to the answer of yesterday. The question was, Paracels and Spartlys, which has been seen in the news, relate to which of the following? Options were A. Antigens identified to fight malaria, B. Proteins for gene editing, C. Islands in South China Sea, and D. None of the above. In this, the correct answer was C, that is islands in the South China Sea. With this, we come to an end to discussion of today's newspaper. Thank you.